What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of this series, we learned how to execute code in parallel via executor services. But if you're writing such multi-threaded code, you have to pay close attention when accessing shared mutable variables from multiple threads. So, say we want to increment an integer accessible by multiple threads. To do that, we define a field for it with a method increment to increase it by 1. Now, if we try to call this method concurrently from multiple threads, we'll be in serious trouble, as instead of seeing a constant output, the actual result varies with every execution of our code, because the access to our variable is not synchronized between these threads, resulting in a race condition. You see, 3 steps have to be performed in order to increment a number. 1. Read the concurrent value. 2. Increase that value. And 3. Write the new value into the variable. If 2 threads perform these steps in parallel, it's possible that both threads perform any of the read, increment, or write operations simultaneously, thus resulting in a wrong output. Luckily, Java supports thread synchronization since its early days via the synchronized keyword. You can check the video linked in the card above where we discuss the synchronized keyword in detail. Now, if you don't want to use implicit locking such as the synchronized keyword, where you throw in that keyword and let Java handle the rest, you'd be happy to know that the concurrency API supports various explicit locks specified by the lock interface. The lock interface grants access to various methods and multiple lock implementations, which are far more expressive than implicit locking, as they provide you with more control over that process. Okay, now, before tackling these various lock implementations, let's discuss monitors. You see, a monitor is more of a concept, and it's not limited to the Java language. In concurrent programming, a monitor is an object intended to be used safely by more than one thread. You all know that every object in Java is a subclass of the java.lang.object class. That object class was created in such a way that it has features and characteristics that allow us to use any object as a monitor. And because of inheritance, every object has a wait queue, a re-entrance queue, a wait and notify methods, making it a monitor. Now, these characteristics, this so-called monitor, also known as monitor lock or intrinsic lock, manages synchronization in Java. So, when you make use of a synchronized method, for example, all threads calling this method will share the same monitor of the object tied to it. All implicit monitors, such as synchronized, implement the reentrant characteristics. Reentrant means that locks are bound to the current thread. A thread can safely reacquire the same lock multiple times without running into deadlocks. With that said, we can now tackle the first lock interface implementation, reentrant locks. The class reentrant lock is a mutual exclusion lock with the same basic behavior as the implicit monitors accessed via the synchronized keyword, but with the extended capabilities we are going to discuss. Take the sample code you see in front of you. It was written using reentrant locks. Here, a lock is acquired via the lock method and released via the unlock method. This method is thread safe, just like its synchronized counterpart. Do not forget to wrap the code in a try finally block, as this will ensure unlocking in case of exceptions. If a thread has already acquired the lock, subsequent calls to the lock method with the same lock pause their thread until the lock has been released. Only one thread can hold the lock at any given time. The lock class supports various methods for retrieving the state of our lock or thread. So, in this example, the first task holds the lock for 2 seconds, and the second task obtains different information about the current state of that lock. The method tryLock tries to acquire the lock without pausing the current thread. The Boolean result must be used to check if the lock has actually been acquired before accessing any shared mutable variables. When you execute this code snippet, you will see that the first attempt at acquiring the lock failed because the first thread we launched already had it. But after 2 seconds, the scheduled thread will acquire the lock. Now, the second type of locks we are going to tackle is the read-write lock. The read-write lock interface specifies another type of lock that maintains not one, but 2 locks, one for read and another one for write access. The idea behind read-write locks is that it's usually safe to read mutable variables concurrently as long as nobody is writing into that variable. So, the read lock can be held simultaneously by multiple threads as long as no threads hold the write lock. This can improve performance and throughput in case reads are more frequent than writes. The code snippet you see first acquires a write lock in order to put a new value to the list and then sleeps for 2 seconds. Before this task has finished, two other tasks are being submitted trying to read the entry from the list and sleep for 2 seconds. When you execute this code, you'll notice that both read tasks have to wait 2 seconds until the write task has finished, and only after the write lock has been released, both read tasks are executed in parallel and print Geekyfic simultaneously to the console. They don't have to wait for each other to finish because read locks can safely be acquired concurrently as long as no write lock is held by another thread. The third and last type of locks we are going to see are stamped locks. They also handle read and write access just like the read-write lock we just saw. However, the difference between them is that the locking method of a stamped lock returns a stamp represented by a long value. These stamps can be used to either release a lock or to check if the lock is still valid. Let's try to rewrite the last code snippet we had using a stamped lock instead of a read-write lock. Obtaining a read or write lock is done via the read lock or write lock method and returns a stamp which is later used for unlocking or releasing that lock within the final block, as you can see in this example. Keep in mind that stamped locks don't implement re-entrant characteristics, so each call to the lock method returns a new stamp and blocks the thread if no lock is available, even if the same thread already holds a lock. So you have to pay close attention not to run into dead locks. Again, here, like the previous example, both read tasks have to wait until the write lock has been released. Then both reads print out simultaneously, as reads don't block each other as long as no write lock is held. Now, on top of the extra stamp returned, stamped locks support another lock mode called optimistic locking. Let's take a look at it in code. An optimistic read lock is acquired by calling tryOptimisticRead, which always returns a stamp without blocking the current thread, no matter if the lock is actually available. If there's already a write lock active, the returned stamp equals 0, and we can always check if a stamp is valid by calling the validate method on the lock object. In this example, the optimistic lock is valid as soon as we submit the task. In contrast to normal read locks, an optimistic lock doesn't prevent other threads in order to obtain a write lock instantaneously. So after sending the first thread to sleep for 2 seconds for the first time, thread number 2 obtains a write lock without waiting for the optimistic read lock to be released. From this point on, the optimistic read lock is no longer valid. Even when the write lock is released, the optimistic read lock stays invalid. Keep in mind that when working with optimistic locks, you have to validate the lock every time after accessing any shared mutable variable to make sure the read is still valid. Okay, now, sometimes it's useful to convert a read lock into a write lock without unlocking and locking again. And stamped locks provide the ability to do so using the tryConvertToWriteLock method. The task you see initially obtains a read lock. However, if for some reason we decided to perform a write operation, we first have to convert that read lock into a write lock to not break potential concurrent access by other threads. Calling tryConvertToWriteLock doesn't block but may return a zero stamp indicating that no write lock is currently available, allowing us to freely call the write lock method to block the concurrent thread. Okay, I'll end this video by tackling the semaphore class in Java, as I get a lot of questions concerning this topic and I want to try to answer them in this last minute. So, the concurrency API supports semaphores. And you see, locks usually grant exclusive access to variables or resources, but a semaphore is capable of maintaining whole sets of permits. It is useful in different scenarios where we have to limit the amount of concurrent access to whole certain parts of the application we are working on. In front of you is an example on how to limit access to a long-running task, simulated here by sleeping for 5 seconds. The executor can potentially run 10 tasks concurrently, but because we are using a semaphore of size 5, we limited the concurrent access to that piece of code to 5. Again, it's important to use a finally block to properly release the semaphore even in case of exceptions. The output of this code is the following. The semaphores permit access to our 5-second running task to a maximum of 5 threads. Every subsequent call to try acquire that elapses the maximum wait time out of 1 second results in the output saying that no semaphore could be acquired. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.